month ago. They split the last four here at G. Raleigh. And we're ready today. Darvin Ham and Brett Murray will jump. Ham has won all but two tips this year, and there's the third that he's lost. They work it underneath, and Joe Wilbert, who is just 3 for 19 from the field his last two games, is 1 for 1 today.
Yeah, and Tony Broney started Wilbert today because Wilbert's really been struggling with his confidence. And Broney said, hey, I don't want him sitting over on the bench like he normally does and thinking about him. I want him ready to play from the get-go. So that was a big bucket for Wilbert starting off.
Mark Davis' jumper is short, and it's A&M ball out of bounds. James Dickey with a five-game winning streak coming in, 48-36, his third year in Lubbock. 15, 18, and 15 wins. And counting this year. Aggies with a 2-0 lead. 8-4 here at home. Last time out, though, upset in double overtime at the hands of Baylor. Wilbert with the miss, picked up by Jason Sasser. The floor, Davis, a nice job saving it before he went out to Lance Hughes, who misses the three. Murray guides the board to David Edwards. A&M's chance to run. Nice up and go. Move underneath.
Oh, was that a sweet hesitation dribble there by David Edwards? He just froze the Tech player in his tracks. Great move.
You tend to think, Reed, of A&M as a team that doesn't want to run. Lately, that hadn't really been the case. Sasser misses the three. Edwards up the floor. There's McGinnis rejected by Davis. Sasser the other way. 3-on-3. Boy Smith underneath. And Darvin Ham with the offensive foul.
Watch this hesitation dribble by David Edwards. Coming down on the right side. Watch. I'm going to pull up. Ah! Did he go by Coy Smith? Woo! That was sweet. Really a great job, Tony Broney's club, of setting the tone for this afternoon game. Great intensity, 10 times more intensity than they've had in their last two games against SMU and Baylor.
A&M averaging over the last 9 games almost 83 points per game. Murray went up on Davis, and Texas Tech with its second foul.
You talked earlier about A&M being a little bit surprising and how much they've been willing to run. That's one of the reasons I'm such a big fan of that man and also of James Dickey, because these two ball clubs, as much as anybody, really will play however you want to play. If you want to play half-court basketball, okay, great. We'll go down there on half-court and run our offense and grind it out. If you want to get up and down, we'll get up and down and run with you. So two very well-coached ball clubs.
Now, what's the deal with Brett Murray's hair?
No significance, no anything other than I understand he got a bad haircut and he said, hey, look, just cut it all off. And between you and me, I've never seen a haircut that bad that would justify it.
That must have been a horrific haircut.
That was one of those Wally giving the beaver a haircut things.
5-0 Aggies, almost 2 minutes into it. And Texas Tech with some good looks so far. Nothing going. Boy Smith converted off guard. At the point for Texas Tech, and Mark Davis draws the contact from Tony McGinnis.
Yeah, Tony McGinnis is going to have his hands full all day long. Mark Davis is a lot bigger. Mark Davis is about 6'7", 6'8", handles the ball extremely well, and Tony McGinnis is going to try to be checking him at 6'5". So look for Mark Davis to do a lot of work inside the paint today.
Peroni says, in a year of excellent newcomers in the Southwest Conference, Davis, the best newcomer. He wanted it over and back here. Does not get it as they glance off at Aggie. Open three-pointer, and Smith is off. Edwards able to get to the rebound, but not able to keep it inbound. Two of the best newcomers in the league on display, Davis and Wilbert. And when I asked Peroni that yesterday, I said, if you can't vote for your own guy who's the best, he said Davis without question.
Oh, yeah, they haven't asked me to vote for that, and I'm glad they haven't, because how do you leave out, you know, Jerome Lambert at Baylor? How do you leave out Roderick Anderson at Texas? I mean, it's just, when you start going through the teams, every team's got a legitimate guy for newcomer of the year, but certainly those are the two top.
Power move inside, and a whistle as Sasser lays it in. So Tech finally gets on the scoreboard, and the foul is on Wilbert.
Now, I'm surprised they don't get the ball out of bounds on this, because watch, Jason Sasser already has the ball out of his hands, the shot's gone, and then the foul's after the shot. That really should be Texas Tech's ball out of bounds. Joe Wilbert cannot afford to get in foul trouble. He's done a good job all year long, but the last two games he has fouled out.
He's fouled out, and in one of those games he was 0 for 6 from the field, a career low 3 early. SMU.
Yeah, and that comes out to 15% from the floor, and that's coming from a guy going into those two games was shooting 70% from the floor. So to say he's been struggling is a drastic understatement. And really, we haven't even mentioned the fact that he's suffering from a cut over his eye. 3 games ago against TCU, he still hadn't gotten over that, and you can see the bandage on his eye.
Rhett Murray out of the double team from 10 feet out. He's got 3 of the first 7 for A&M. Wilbert, though, before the game said, I'm 100%, no blurred vision, no problem. Bam with the slam.
That was strong.
They keep track of the dunks, Reed. At Tech, that's his 33rd to lead the team. Murray for a 3.
And that is a huge bucket for A&M. The reason SMU was so successful against A&M is because Brett Murray and the other post players could not hit that shot up at the top of the key. So for Murray to pull up and hit a 3, watch this beautiful pass by Mark Davis. And then watch, Cam doesn't just dunk it. I mean, he tries to break the thing. He pulls it back behind his head. That is one strong kid there.
Prior to the 3-point shot by Hughes, a foul on Chuck Henderson off the ball. Another foul as Sasser is fouled by Murray on the inbounds pass.
Dave, you've been doing Southwest Conference for 10 years?
5 years.
When's the last time you saw Texas Tech game notes where they told you how many dunks the players had?
Well, ever since Lance Hughes arrived on the scene. That's been a staple. Jeff Taylor used to rack them up as well. Then kind of an off period. There's Hughes, and as he goes to the hoop, already the 5th A&M team foul. In just a little over 3 minutes, and Chuck Henderson second. A&M honoring their 5 graduating seniors today. Tony Barone before the game handing them each plaques, escorted by their parents as available to make it to the game. And a nice moment. But the foul problem already looming for A&M with their 10-5 edge on the scoreboard. Cam with position on Wilbert will get it inside, and another foul, but this one's on him for a clear out elbow.
What happens in that situation, anytime that you're fronting somebody and the ball goes over your head, you ought to flop forward like you got pushed. But whether you did or not, the tendency is for the ref to look for that, because if the offensive player is just holding you off with his form, it's going to look like he pushes you as he releases to catch the ball.
Marvin Ham with his 2nd foul. Tony McGinnis to the hoop. Maybe Ham getting a piece of that. Sasser long to Hughes, who might have gotten away with a travel.
Yeah, he sure did.
Hughes, one of the top dunkers in college basketball. 3-pointer by Chuck Henderson, is one of the top 3-point shooters in the league. And the all-time 3-point ace at A&M. They lead 13-7. Ham's no-look pass to Davis, and another Aggie foul. 2nd on McGinnis, their 6th as a team.
Let's watch and see if Lance doesn't take one little extra step when he catches it. And here it is, a nice, strong, aggressive move by Tony McGinnis. And he didn't stick it in, but Tony Brunny will take that. And let's watch the catches, step.
3 steps.
Step. Hey, he's getting ready for that NBA career. Said, no, that was a good move. That's one of those ones Tony Brunny jumps up and says, ref, give him a bus token. He won't have to travel so far.
Nice touch from Mark Davis. Just about every individual category there is in this league, you can find Mark Davis. 7th in the league in scoring, 6th in rebounding, 9th in assists, 8th in blocks and steals, and 1st in turnovers. He'd just as soon not be there. Timeout, 15-59 in the first half, and the Aggies with a 4-point lead.
Any car with airbags will help protect you in a head-on collision. The new Volkswagen Golf has airbags, crumple zones, and side impact beams, so it can help protect you from any angle, including this one.
Because most of our flights are short, this is what our meals look like on Southwest Airlines. It's also what our fares look like. Southwest Airlines, it's just plain smart. Southwest Airlines has one of the best on-time records in the country.
Mr. Smith, you're early.
Just something to remember. Southwest Airlines, it's just plain smart.
The new Volkswagen Golf features a track-correcting rear axle and an improved turning radius of just 32 and a half feet, all of which makes the tight-handling Golf the perfect car for the city.
You know what's special about this Chevy Country truck? It's a used Chevy Country truck. And right now, Chevy Country has more than 250 quality used cars, trucks, and vans at some very low prices. And don't forget that when you buy your used car, truck, or van at Chevy Country, you get free lifetime oil and filter changes and a service department that's open 7 days a week. Austin is Chevy Country, and Chevy Country is where Austin shops for used cars.
The elusive, beguiling David Edwards on the NCI proof positive replay.
And you want to know why he's first in the Southwest Conference and second in the country in assists? Yank!
You see Coy Smith's face as he went by? He's like, oh, no. Beautiful pass. Beautiful play.
David Edwards, number two in the nation. 8.5 assists per game. Oh, by the way, look whose record's about to fall.
Uh-oh. You know what's funny? I looked at that last night and I thought, gee whiz, just think if David Edwards played with Akeem Olajuwon and Clyde Drexler. You want to talk about some serious assists. I mean, this kid's played on a team that his first year won 6 games, his second year won 10 games, and to put up those kind of numbers is absolutely nothing short of phenomenal.
So why did you only have 8 points?
Well, that just shows that they could put a dead man out there that could average 8-4 with those guys.
And Murray just inside the three-point arc. And Murray with the unexpected early score.
Yeah, the fixing. Ooh, what a pick.
Here comes Edwards. Sasser and Chase sees him go by. Aggies open up an 8-point lead. More contact, the blocking foul. Edwards first, team's seventh. So we're less than 5 minutes into the first half, and Tech is already in the bonus.
That was a beautiful sequence of play right there. David Edwards gets the steal, makes the layup on this end, and then is down underneath the basket in time to almost draw a charge. Oh, they said he was shooting. Oh, no, 1-1.
Boy Smith going to the line, 78% free throw shooter. Last year at off guard alongside Lenny Holland. He's taken Holly's point guard spot this year with pretty good reviews.
Yeah, I think Coy's done an outstanding job of adjusting to point guard. And it's really tough because Coy Smith's not only an off guard, but he's a pure shooting off guard. I mean, that's his game, is to spot up and shoot. And so James Dickey has asked Coy Smith to do a lot of different things this year, and the young man has responded very, very well.
17-11. A&M yet to turn the ball over. Tech with 3 early turnovers. First 3 minutes, an extremely fast pace, and now a little more methodical for A&M. Outside shot, short for Wilbur. In fact, whenever they get the rebound, first thing they do, they look for the long bomb. This time, not there. 3-point shot was there for Smith. And touched last by Texas Tech. You know what's amazing about David Edwards is he rebounds with the big guys. He's over 5 rebounds per game.
Yeah, unbelievable. He by far leads this A&M team in defensive rebounds, and that's coming from a guy 5'9". Absolutely remarkable how well he rebounds basketball. In fact, he's led this A&M team 6 different games this year in rebounding, and that ties for the lead with their center, Brett Murray.
Joe Wildert will go to the line. Today, Cooper with the foul. He has just checked in. Take the Gillette 3-point challenge. Clip the coupon in your Sunday, March 13th newspaper. Go to a participating retailer to see if you've won a shot at $1 million. No purchase necessary, Boyd. We're prohibited. Well, this season really has followed Joe Wilbert's path. When he got hot and established himself as one of the top 6 men in basketball, that's when A&M was surging. And with his eye injury, and with his shooting problems, the whole team has had shooting problems, and they've lost their last 2.
Yeah, that's exactly right. It's hard to say that he's more valuable than David Edwards, because he's not. But that's certainly been the case this year, that as Joe Wilbert's gone, so has this Aggie basketball team.
Before the injury, he was threatening the league record from the field, 70%.
Phenomenal.
And now down to 57%.
Yeah, it's not like he was just putting up 4 or 5 shots a game. He was averaging 20 points a game while shooting that well.
Davis and Cooper inside. Cooper with the putback of the miss by Sasser. Three-pointer Henderson is second.
Hey, are these A&M seniors ready to play basketball this afternoon?
This is it. G. Raleigh for the five seniors and then the tournament next week. This travel they do call on Hughes. And Tech with its fourth turnover. Well, the stakes today, if Texas Tech wins, they can be the number two seed in the conference tournament if Rice and SMU win today. Rice plays Houston, SMU plays Baylor. A&M can be the top seed if they win and TCU wins in the game right after our game against Texas in Fort Worth. TCU has won the last three in Fort Worth against Texas.
Hey, you did that. You did that tiebreaker really well. I was looking at you amazed. I spent an hour on that last night. Finally went, oh, well, Dave will figure it out and explain it to me.
Speaking of the tournament, the Dr. Pepper Classic here on Raycom, the semis beginning at 6 next Friday from Reunion Arena in Dallas. Cooper called for his second foul for Texas Tech. McGinnis going inside. And Davis with a leaping save, but it's down to Damon Johnson, who's rejected by Davis. Johnson, who started most of the year in off the bench today. McGinnis chasing down Sasser, out of bounds off Sasser.
Yeah, Tony Brony is furious at Damon Johnson. The reason is Damon did a great job of hustle, then got the ball, took a big power dribble, then just did a little wimpy shot and just laid it up there and let Mark Davis slap it down. Hey, when you're in that position, if you're not going to dunk it, you got to at least put your hand up on that backboard and hard and not let the defensive player get his hand up between the ball and the backboard.
Looking for Murray inside. Pretty well covered up by Sasser, and a steal for Chad Collins, the backup point guard for Tech. Out of bounds, and it will be Red Raider ball. Aggies touch it last over there in front of the Texas Tech bench. The tie is gone. Now, how long will the shirt last? Code, I don't think, made it into the second minute. Davis's runner just exudes talent, doesn't he?
Yeah, he sure does. He really, I mean, if ever I saw a born NBA player, it's this kid. I mean, he just can do everything there is to do on the basketball floor. He'll play, it won't be unusual for him to play all five positions today. You'll see him post up, you'll see him out on the wing and drive. And that's a kid that's 6'8", just an outstanding basketball player. Certainly will be one of the best players in the conference. Already is now, but next year will really be one of the premier stars of the conference.
Look for him to dominate next year. Ball kicked out of bounds off Collins.
As well as his teammates. The Texas Tech Red Raiders do not have a senior on the ball club, and you've got to think coming into the season next year that they'll be the hands-down pick to win it. Whatever it is.
You think some people in Austin might disagree with that, don't you?
Yeah, I do. But when you talk about losing Albert Burdett, you talk about losing B.J. Tyler, hey, Tom Penders is going to just run thoroughbreds in, and he's going to have a great team. But I think going into it on paper, you're going to have to favor the Red Raiders. Or I am, anyway.
Corey Henderson with a missed three-pointer. And a rebound foul. Damon Johnson, who has been overshadowed this year by the development of Joe Wilbert, and in fact, eclipsed as a starter at least today by Wilbert. But Baroni said one reason for that, he didn't want Wilbert to sit on the bench and wonder whether his vision will be okay. He wanted to answer that question in the first minute of the game.
Yeah, and all year long, he's brought Wilbert off the bench as a sixth man. And when you're in a groove and you're playing well, sitting over on the bench can be a positive because you can sit there, you can kind of get a feel for the game, you can figure out what's going to happen, and then check in the game and do it. But if you're struggling and your confidence is down, sitting over on that bench when everyone else is playing, you start wondering, oh, gosh, I wonder how I'm going to play. I wonder. So Tony Brony just erased any problem with that and just started the kid.
With the miss by Cooper, still 21-15. Johnson stifled inside, and the second chance goes. A&M by eight. About 8 minutes into the game. Knocked out by Henderson. He saves it, and it touched Mark Davis last.
Brett Murray is second on this A&M basketball team in assists, and there you see why. That's a really difficult pass to make inside. He wasn't down at a good passing angle. He's up at the top of the key and went straight down the lane. That's an outstanding pass by Brett Murray.
Work defensive ability also by Cooper. One block and one near block. Edwards shaking, baking, and missing. scrapes it from Davis. Can't hustle any more than A&M is hustling in this first half. Going after everything, and they lead 23-15, 11:49 and a half.
Smack dab in the middle of Tennessee is a city that strikes a chord in people the world over. But the flip side of Nashville is that it's also a major financial center because it's served by Nations Bank, enabling Opryland USA to work in concert with the nation's largest treasury management group, giving the Williams smarter ways to pay for college, and providing the kind of performance that satisfies even the toughest customers in Nashville and in 1,900 other communities throughout our nation.
Brian Jesse had just purchased a Texas Lottery instant ticket when...
Uh-oh.
Don't worry! Scratchman is here.
Play Texas Bonus Card and try your hand at doubling your winnings.
Sorry about that.
Scratchman, in pursuit of instant winners.
To play this game, you got to have the drive. You got to have the moves. You got to have the love. But most importantly...
Hey, man, you got the ball?
No, I ain't got the ball. You got it? Say what? Nobody
you got to have the ball.
Somebody better bring the ball.
Hey, Chumps. Want a game?
The all-new street ball. It's a Rawlings. It's only $4.99 and only at Pizza Hut. Get one, because nobody plays without the ball.
Today's game is brought to you in part by MasterCard and by La Quinta. With Reed Geddes, Dave Barnett in College Station. And a good start for Tony Barone and the Aggies, an 8-point lead. 11:49 to play first half.
I think the point you made going into timeout was a great observation, in that A&M was getting to all the loose balls and they were picking up all the trash off the floor. And that's what they didn't do the last two games, and especially against SMU.
Mark Davis, top Raider scorer so far with 6. Quickly down to Wilbert, traveling on Joe Wilbert, just the second turnover against A&M.
Yeah, and that's a good call. And Tony Bruni's mad because Wilbert got fouled, and he's right. He did get fouled, but he definitely shuffled his feet as he was trying to get his footwork to go up for that shot. That was a good call. A&M now in a 2-3 zone.
Collins, Hughes, and Davis, the three-guard look. Hughes misses the three. Cooper misses the putback, stays after it, though, and he gets fouled.
And what a great job the 6'8 freshman has done for James Dickey. Janae Cooper hardly played at all early on in the year, and the last month has really come on to be a solid, solid basketball player. It really started against SMU. He had 4 blocks against SMU, and then each game he's played a little bit better and a little bit better, and now James Dickey has no hesitation at all to go with the freshman and has complete confidence in him, and it's well-deserved. We've already seen him get a couple of blocks today, and here he is getting a couple of rebounds on the offensive end.
And you're talking about a team that needed to develop some kind of depth.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Needed, and that's what everyone said all along, is that, hey, they've got a terrifically talented starting five, but what does James Dickey have coming off the bench? Well, he's answered that with great, solid play from Chad Collins and also Janae Cooper.
Cooper out of Colleen Ellison. One of 2 free throws and a rebound foul. This is the 6th against Texas Tech and the 1st on Jason Sasser. So Tech one away from giving A&M the bonus. A&M one away from giving Tech the 2-shot bonus. Murray 8. Early points to spark A&M. Raiders slowly coming back within 5, 23-18. Wilbert shooting still somewhat off. Off the spin move, rejected by Mark Davis. Hughes in a foot race with Edwards. Lance Hughes, 4th point, they're within 3.
I'm surprised Brett Murray's quit shooting that shot, and he's already hit 2 in the game, and now he's not even looking for it.
Sasser going up with Wilbert, and that may cost him his 2nd. Wilbert already with 2.
Joe,
so they give it to Cooper, and that's 3 on him.
Joe Wilbert is concentrating so hard on getting involved in the action and scoring down low that he's not realizing when he's catching the ball down there, he is drawing a serious crowd. He's got three Red Raiders around him. And what needs to happen in that situation is that when he catches the ball, watch how many Red Raiders are around him. Now, when he gets this many guys around him, there's three guys around him. Brett Murray has got to come down the lane, and they have to get some post-to-post passing. Brett Murray will be wide open at the dotted, at the, well, A&M doesn't have a dotted line. I looked out there and said at the dotted line. Like, there's no dotted line. Right below the free throw line, Brett Murray will be open for a jump shot if he'll pass the ball, an entry pass, and then cut.
Wilbert so far today, 1-for-4 from the field, now 1-for-3 from the line.
What's interesting, Mark Davis is pointing out that Joe Wilbert's bleeding again. And what happens, the new rule is that if someone's got blood coming from them, they've got to check out of the game. So if you see the other team's best player bleeding, you go point it out to the ref. Say, ref, he's bleeding. He's got to go sit down.
In his own best interest, of course.
Oh, of course.
I don't think I've seen this, though, where the player involved was in the middle of free throws. Now, you'll see this happen. He has to come out until they stop the bleeding. But in this instance.
Now, they've taken the sutures out of that eye. I won't be surprised if he doesn't have to go back in. And they're going to have to rebandage it. And they may have to put more stitches in there to get that bleeding to stop. They just took it out a couple days ago.
And here's Damon Johnson ready to check in as Wilbert is down getting some attention on the end of the Aggie bench. The Grade 8, a two-day tournament matching this year's NCAA Final 8, is coming to the Palace of Auburn Hills November 29th and 30th. Tickets range from $39 to $99 and will be distributed through a national lottery due to the expected high demand. To enter the lottery, send a postcard to that address or call 1-810-377-0100. And Johnson finishing off that free throw opportunity. It's still just a three-point A&M lead. Tech doing a good job settling things down. Sasser just 3 points so far. The leading scorer almost carried it. Davis just inside the three-point arc. Bernard Lloyd in, got the rebound, and Sasser got the follow. With a foul, the offensive foul against Texas Tech.
A&M has really done a good job at keeping Jason Sasser somewhat under control. Sasser is one of the premier players in the conference in every aspect of the game and has really been playing well. And we haven't heard from him much so far.
He picks up his second. Bernard Lloyd in the game to defend against Johnson because Cooper picked up his third a moment ago. Johnson, just like Wilbert Reed, not really aware of how well guarded he is.
Yeah, the A&M post players are trying to do too much. They've got to catch the ball, check the defense, and then the flip side of that is the other guys on A&M have got to give the post players something to do with the ball. You can't just throw it to the post and stand there and watch him. You've got to do a cross cut or cut through the middle or something, but just giving some options.
Davis, junior college All-American from Howard College, Big Spring, Texas. Sasser on the baseline. Number four scorer, number three rebounder in the Southwest Conference. 20 points, 9 boards per game. Murray, his second three-pointer today.
And he hasn't missed out there. He ought to have his eyes just big as saucers won the ball at the top of the key.
Boy, Brett Murray, 11 points in this half. He averages 9 per game. Davis, sweet pass inside. Lloyd couldn't put it down. It's rebounded by Lance Broderson, who's off the bench. Henderson cross court to Henderson. Shot from Corey for three, his third three-pointer. A&M back up by 7. Coy Smith quiets the G. Raleigh Crazies.
And great job of coaching. Go ahead and take advantage of Coy Smith's height advantage on David Edwards and post him up.
Just off for Corey Henderson. Sasser did not see Edwards from behind. Lloyd, a nice alert save, knocked out by Edwards. And it will be Tech ball.
Let's look again at Jason Sasser working hard for the ball. And what happened right there, you saw Brett Murray as Jason Sasser came off that double screen. You've got to make a decision. You've got to either trail him and go behind him or go over the top. Good job, attacker, recognizing he went over the top. Therefore, the pass should come on the baseline side.
Hughes a three. 7 for Lance Hughes. They cut it back to a two-point game. Murray, this time guarded out there by Lloyd. Roberson in deep.
All that credit goes to Brett Murray. He showed a little head fake up there, and he's shooting the ball so well. Immediately, Bernard Lloyd had to come out to contest him, which gave Lance Roberson a little more room inside.
A&M has yet to miss a three-pointer. Not one of the better shooting three-point teams in the league. In fact, they have the worst percentage, 29%. And after the Tech turnover, 7:53 to go in the first half. We'll be back after this from our friends at Schick.
Since your face can't adjust to your razor should adjust to your face, which is exactly why we designed the Schick Tracer. The Schick Tracer is the only razor with blades that bend and flex to the unique shape of your face. So the Tracer gets in close for a clean, comfortable shave. And since you can't change your face, maybe you should change your razor. Schick. We're changing the face of shaving. From the top of the highest mountain, over land, over sea, in the desert, in the pits, when it absolutely has to start, the battery is Die Hard. Sears Die Hard, more power when and where you need it most.
If your brother takes from you, you give to him. And if he slanders you, you sing his praises. But if he ever, ever messes with Texas, pray for him, brother. Pray for him. Pray for him.
Today's game is brought to you in part by the Texas Lottery. Tonight's Lotto Texas estimated jackpot is $20 million. 7:53 first half, 31-27. And that is the reverse of what anybody would have expected. Brett Murray outscoring Jason Sasser, who averages 11 more points per game than does Brett Murray. The biggest reason the Aggies have led from the outset. Murray on the post move, just off. Long rebound, Edwards, and Murray with the slam.
What a great touch pass by David Edwards to rifle it back into Brett Murray. And credit to Brett Murray being ready for the pass. That would have hit a lot of guys right between the eyes.
Sasser with the hook answers. And he's starting to loosen up. 7 points. 33-29. Edwards tries the three. A&M had been perfect on their first 5 three-point tries. On the year, they have been outscored from the line by 44. So they have reversed that trend just in time today. Sasser over Murray again. That's three straight swishes for him.
Yeah, and that's big. Brent Murray's a great defensive player. Last year, he kept great Will Flemons from even scoring and held Brent Scott of Rice to just one bucket. So that's a big bucket for Jason Sasser to take it, to take Brent Murray down on the blocks and beat him.
10 Southwest Conference wins this year for A&M. Last 3 years combined, they had won a total of 9. Roderson and Henderson, but taken by Smith. For the Raiders and a chance to tie it here. Sasser again, twice off the backboard, 33-33.
A minute ago, wasn't I saying Jason Sasser's a little quiet? I mean, take care of that.
Tony Barone wants timeout, 6:09 in the half, and the Red Raiders trailing all day have pulled even.
Think you're ready for the new La Quinta Inns?
It was very important for us to have good curb appeal.
Curb appeal? You know, the front door is an incredible, powerful event.
The tile has been washed with almost a whitewash finish.
Yeah, they did do a good job down there, didn't they?
Well, yeah, I've noticed that. To me, at the end of the workday, I like La Quinta. I've driven 50 miles all the way to go to La Quinta.
The new La Quinta. You're not staying at a hotel. You're staying with us.
What a joy to come in here.
Tylenol? For fever and things, it's great, sure. But headaches? My headaches? It's not always strong enough. So I went and got Excedrin. For that one reason. Excedrin's better than Tylenol at relieving headaches. That's enough of a reason for me. You use what works better, right? Tylenol for some things. But for headaches, Excedrin.
Excedrin, the headache medicine.
Every Monday, I send out for Schlotzky's. It's good luck. One Monday, I was eating a Schlotzky's original. You know, three hot belly meats, real Wisconsin cheese, lettuce, tomatoes, onions, olives on those famous sourdough buns. When my buddy calls, boom, two Super Bowl tickets. Another Monday, my wife calls about the sonogram. She says you could see his little, toes. So, when I have Schlotzky's on Monday, I feel lucky.
Schlotzky's, Austin, San Marcos, and Round Rock.
Brett Murray, if you don't succeed at first, keep trying. Here it is on the MCI Proof Positive replay.
And Brett Murray did a good job at checking the defense first and then making a good strong move. Watch this beautiful touch pass by Edwards. Bop! He looked like a setter on a volleyball team. Just bopped it over to Brett Murray for the putback. Great job of Brett Murray being aware of David Edwards. And that comes from the fact that he's played with him for 3 and 4 years now. Brett Murray was here as a redshirt 1 year, so he's accustomed to David Edwards, and he knows when you're on the floor with David Edwards, you better keep your head up and keep your eyes on the ball or you're going to get hit with a pass.
Lance Gruderson with four off the bench. At the end of the game, we'll select the Dr. Pepper player of the game. Murray, a pretty good candidate so far. And Sasser with the last 8 points in a row for Tech. They had a 6-0 run until Broderson's bucket. Had briefly pulled even. Five and a half minutes. First half, Hughes called for the walk. He's a little off his rhythm today.
He is a little bit off his rhythm, but the credit for that turnover has to go to the A&M pressure, getting out there and denying passing lanes. They're getting hands up in the passing lane, and Lance Hughes just didn't have anyone to throw the ball to.
Almost all the points for Tech come from three guys. Sasser 20 per game, Davis 18 per game, and Hughes ninth in the league at 17 and a half per game. And the others fill in around the edges pretty well. Joe Wilbert back in. They fixed the cut, but he has not fixed his shooting problems. Rejected by Mark Davis. Here comes Coy Smith. Underneath to Darvin Ham for the slam dunk.
Man, is that strong or what?
Whew. Two dunks today, 34 for the year. Roberson three-pointer. He'll get a tap right back to him. Underneath McGinnis, count it, and a foul on Davis.
Nice interior passing. Look what a great job Tony McGinnis does of turning his body, and that's what you want to do. You want to turn the body, and then another beautiful pass on a Texas Tech fast break for a ham dunk.
Ham slam.
A ham slam dunk. Slam ham dunk.
Something like that.
Something like that.
Back out Wilbert. This has got to be a cause of major concern for Tony Bruni. He has got to get him straightened out, not only for the rest of today, but with the tournament in the next weekend. Well, once again, Tech can tie or lead with a three-pointer. Sasser lost it. Broderson knocked it away. Mark Davis from about 18. And Broderson with the board. Really a game of runs so far. A great start for A&M, pumped by the fact that it's senior day here and a good enthusiastic crowd. Tech responded. Now A&M getting control once more. Four three-pointers in the half by Chuck Henderson.
Chuck Henderson just absolutely buried that shot. Caught the ball and got it out of his hands so quick. He's shooting 45% from the three-point line in conference play.
Tech sees him in their nightmares. He had two in the final minutes of A&M's upset in Lubbock in the first game.
Texas Tech gets so much leadership from Jason Sasser, and it's always surprising because Jason Sasser's only a sophomore. But every time A&M's had a run, Tech's come back and gone to Jason Sasser.
Here's Chuck Henderson. He owns all the three-point shooting records here at A&M. He is one of the seniors finally on scholarship this year. He walked on. He was a non-scholarship player until his senior year. Sasser really taking the miss hard.
Coaches always tell you when you shoot your free throw, you should have all your weight and everything going in a positive direction towards the basket. I think Jason Sasser took that one a little too far.
Interesting thing here, he's got 500 points. They have never had three in one year with 500. That could happen this year. Davis came in with 447, Hughes with 437 points. The only time they have ever had as many as two 500-point scorers one year, 70-71, Gene Knoll and Greg Lowry. Aggies up four. Roterson has done nicely off the bench. Hughes very respectful of Henderson's range, as he should be. Roterson against Sasser, who backs off. Hughes almost losing the rebound. 3:20 in the half. A&M, when they lead at the half, almost unbeaten this year. Smith going up with Broderson. And his second foul. When the Aggies lead at intermission, they're 14-2. When they trail at halftime, a different story. Just 2-5 on the year.
That statistic gets added significance from the fact that Texas Tech also does well when they lead at half. When they lead at half, they're 11-2. So the first half of basketball is very important for both of these ball clubs.
Boy Smith off his best game of the year, 20 points, in a narrow win against the Horned Frogs, 94-90 Wednesday.
It was interesting. Coy Smith said that he really felt like he was in the groove just in warm-ups of the game. Said he was just shooting the ball and getting a feel and getting ready to play. He knew he was going to be in a groove against TCU. And this is the one dimension, if you had any, not criticism, but concern for the Red Raiders, they're firing on all the cylinders except Coy Smith's three-point shooting. So Wednesday night's performance against TCU was huge for the ball club.
Be sure to join us at halftime when we update Southwest Conference women's basketball on the Volkswagen Women's Halftime Report. That's 3 minutes away. A&M 40-37. Murray loses it, and it rolls over to Mark Davis. Three-pointer, Coy Smith for the tie. Rebound by the little big man, David Edwards. At 5'9", their third leading rebounder. Wilbert held to just 3 points in this half, and yet his team up by three. Give Murray most of the credit for that, along with Henderson's three-point bomb. Wilbert hard to the hoop this time, draws the foul.
Joe Wilbert's got to realize that he not only has to beat his man, but he's going to have to beat somebody else, too, because anytime he goes in the paint, somebody's coming over the top trying to block his shot.
All the fouls from now on are two-shot fouls. That one, the first on Bernard Lloyd. And A&M just 2-for-7 from the line. Wilbert 1-for-3 today.
And that's surprising because A&M is a very, very good free throw shooting team. They're number two in the Southwest Conference in free throw shooting.
Well, he said before the game that his vision was fine. You have to really wonder about that.
A lot of times you never know. You talk to kids, and he may be trying to convince himself. He may say, hey, look, I don't have a physical problem. It's just all mental. My eye's fine. Nothing's bothering me. Because if you're in a game and you're getting ready to play and you're focused and you're thinking, yeah, it is affecting me, it is bothering me, then it's going to bother you when you start playing.
1-for-5 for Joe Wilbert from both the field and the line. Tech down by three.
I think Tech ought to go post Coy Smith up on David Edwards some more.
Traveling, Mark Davis with the latest Texas Tech turnover. That's 10 in this first half.
They've only done that once this afternoon, and Coy was able just to post up and do one little step turnaround inside the paint. Coy Smith at 6'4", 6'5", jumps really well, and 5'9", David Edwards on him. I think I'd exploit that advantage.
One thing you had your eye on today was the rebounding. Tech with a 7-rebound edge today, and they were outboarded badly in the first meeting.
Especially on the offensive boards. Tech just dominated the offensive rebounding when these two teams met earlier in Lubbock.
Nice block by Lloyd. He slowed down that time. Looked like they had a transition change. One-on-one, Hughes and Henderson. Lance Hughes has 9, and he has Tech within 1 again.
Goodness. Lance Hughes just absolutely took Chuck Henderson that time and stuck the ball right in his face and knocked him down when he hit the shot.
Wilbert about as far away from the bucket as he can get this time.
Little pick and roll with David Edwards.
Really, for the first time all day, the shot clock becomes a factor here. It's down to 7. We're under 1 minute and a half. Down to 5 for Edwards, whose runner is off. Knocked out to Smith. 50 seconds and a half. Tech again shoots for the lead. But they travel again. 11 turnovers, most of them have been ball handling problems like that one.
Yeah, and just silly ones. He's standing out there pivoting, and there wasn't a lot of pressure on him. And look, for a season, they're only averaging 16 turnovers a game. So to have 11 in the first half, I don't think you have to have any doubts about what James Dickey's going to hammer on at halftime.
If they win today, Tech with a 6-game win streak, which would be their longest in 8 years, which coincidentally was a championship year for them, 85-86. They hope that there's a tie in there. Shot clock at 12 as you look at time remaining first half. Now down to 7 for Edwards. Murray, another 3-point try, airs it out. Davis with 12 seconds. Will bring the rebound up. All alone, Collins for 3 off the side of the glass. Edwards, Henderson at the buzzer, too late and too long. First game this year, a 1-point A&M win. Second game at the half, a 1-point A&M lead at G. Raleigh White Coliseum in College Station, Texas. Southwest Conference basketball on Raycom is brought to you by Southwest Airlines. By Miller Genuine Draft. And by Pizza Hut. Our halftime show continues after these messages.
What's the difference between Diet Dr. Pepper and regular Dr. Pepper? Can't see the difference, can't hear it. The amazing thing is you probably can't taste the difference either. Discover what millions already have, the great taste of Diet Dr. Pepper.
Without knowing, American businesses wasted $1 billion last year by using the wrong long-distance company. $1 billion that could have been reinvested in those businesses. That's why MCI announces $1 billion stimulus plan for American business. Get all the savings from Proof Positive, plus we'll send you a check that doubles your savings every time you get a Proof Positive statement this year. Call and make the most stimulating investment of all, an investment in your business.
And now it's time for the MCI Proof Positive Play of the Week. Texas Tech at Rice, and it's the Red Raiders' Coy Smith with a great pass to Darvin Ham for the slam dunk. The Red Raiders go on to beat Rice 76-62 as Tech looks awesome at tournament time. Darvin Ham scores 8 points and supplies the Southwest Conference with the MCI Proof Positive Play of the Week.
Accidents happen when you're in a hurry and not careful. Don't wreck your life.
The average ice cube can't taste the difference between Diet Dr. Pepper and regular Dr. Pepper. But the amazing thing is, you probably can't either. Discover what millions already have. The great taste of Diet Dr. Pepper.
Many people assume that Texas Tech has strong programs and technology. We do. Our faculty are known worldwide for their work in lasers, disaster research, and computers. But Texas Tech is also the Health Sciences Center, improving medical care in West Texas. And Texas Tech is law and business and agriculture and more than 150 other fields, from the arts to zoology. At Texas Tech, our horizons are unlimited.
This is, you know, a wonderful profession. It's a lot of fun being a veterinarian.
She's been someone who I've definitely looked up to.
As gentle as veterinarians have to be with animals, I'd say she's very gentle with the students.
Through Texas A&M's Dr. Teresa Fossum, both male and female veterinary students see the person they'd someday like to be.
America's colleges and universities. Great dreams need great teachers.
Welcome again to G. Raleigh White and College Station. Everything we thought this one would be, close, 40-39 at the half. As we welcome you again, Dave Barnett and Reed Geddes. Two ties, no lead changes, and as much as an 8-point lead early for A&M, but Tech, Reed, slowly coming back and never really quite over the top.
Yeah, and like you said a couple times during the game, this has really been a game of runs. A&M came out, started great. Texas answered the call. A&M made another call. Tech came back. Really a great ball game. And we said early on, we wanted a repeat of the game that they had in Lubbock, and that's what we're getting.
Our first half highlights brought to you by MasterCard. You got to talk about the three-point shooting, first of all, for A&M and Chuck Henderson.
Yeah, Chuck Henderson, 4 three-pointers in the first half, and all of them from that exact same spot. But equally important has been the three-point shooting of big Brett Murray. Really did a great job. Hit 2 or 3 three-pointers out there and has done a great job of loosening things up on the inside. On the other side, every time A&M made a run, Tech went to their main man, their ultimate warrior, Jason Sasser. Had 12 points in the first half. It was really quiet the first part of the first half, and then hit 4 or 5 buckets in a row.
1-point A&M lead at halftime when we return to College Station after this.
Think you're ready for the new La Quinta Inns?
It was very important for us to have good curb appeal.
Curb appeal? You know, the front door is an incredible, powerful event.
The tile has been washed with almost a whitewash finish.
You know, they did do a good job down there, didn't they?
Well, yeah, I've noticed that.
To me, at the end of the workday, I like La Quinta. I've driven 50 miles all the way to go to La Quinta.
The new La Quinta. You're not staying at a hotel. You're staying with us.
What a joy to come in here.
Hey, the Miss Perfect pageant.
Yeah.
We're watching hockey.
Let's watch both.
Miller Lite presents the Miss Perfect Face-Off.
Okay, Bob, Miss Georgia goes to the corner. She pays the price. Here's the puck coming loose. The shot. She's gone.
Brought to you by Miller Lite. If you can combine great taste and less filling, you can combine anything.
Oh, that'll be sashing. 2 minutes for Miss Congeniality.
Bad call.
Good beer.
Great taste, less filling. Can your beer do this?
Brian Jesse had just purchased a Texas Lottery instant ticket when...
Uh-oh.
Don't worry! Scratchman is here.
Play Texas Bonus Card and try your hand at doubling your winnings.
Sorry about that.
Scratchman, in pursuit of instant winners.
Since your face can't adjust to your razor should adjust to your face, which is exactly why we designed the Schick Tracer. The Schick Tracer is the only razor with blades that bend and flex to the unique shape of your face. So the Tracer gets in close for a clean, comfortable shave. And since you can't change your face, maybe you should change your razor. Schick. You're changing the face of shaving.
After graduation, I want to be governor of Texas.
Governor of Texas. Governor of Texas. Governor of Texas. Governor of Texas. Governor of Texas. Governor of Colorado. Well, 5 out of 6 isn't bad.
With the schools of the Southwest Conference, higher education turns dreams into reality.
March Madness returns to Dallas March 9th through the 12th at the Dr. Pepper Southwest Conference Classic and Hoopla Festival. See the best of the SWC as all eight men's and women's teams battle for the 1994 championship title. And backed by popular demand is the Hoopla Festival, featuring live entertainment, food, games, and lots of fun. Stake your claim now to the best seats in the house by calling the SWC ticket hotline, 1-800-800-7928. Don't miss the Hoopla in Dallas at the Dr. Pepper Southwest Conference Classic.
Let's check out the week in Southwest Conference women's basketball on the Volkswagen Women's Report. The surprising Texas A&M Lady Aggies, led by Lisa Branch, are tied for first in the Southwest Conference with one game remaining. SMU made it to the NIT championship game last year. Now they're a possibility for a first ever NCAA berth, as the Southwest Conference could have four teams in the big party. The standings heading into the final weekend of play. Tech and A&M tied for first at 11-2, followed by Texas at 9-4, SMU a game over 500, Houston at 5-8, Rice and Baylor, followed by TCU at the bottom. The schedule today at 2 o'clock, Baylor, SMU, Houston, Rice, the big one in Lubbock, 3 o'clock, already sold out. A&M and Tech battle for the regular season championship, and tomorrow at 2, TCU is at the Lady Longhorns. The Dr. Pepper Southwest Conference Classic will tip off at Moody Coliseum with the quarterfinals on Wednesday. Back to Reunion Arena Friday for the semifinals and Saturday's championship game. We'll return after these messages from your local station. This is the Raycom Network.
If you haven't been to Chevy Country lately, you're in for a surprise. We've got a huge selection of new Camaros, S10 pickups, and Suburbans in stock and ready for immediate delivery. But there's more. Chevy Country's parts and service departments are now open 7 days a week for your convenience. And speaking of service, you get free lifetime oil and filter changes with your new Chevy Country car or truck. Free! If you haven't been to Chevy Country lately, come and see us. Chevy Country, Highway 183, just north of the Arboretum.
Did you know asphalt roofs crack, deteriorate, and leak unless protected from the weather? And replacement cost is high. Protect your investment. Save your existing roof with an easy-to-paint-on, cool, white, reflective, elastic coating of Snow Roof. Whatever type roof you have, Snow Roof Systems' maintenance program preserves and protects for less. Do your own roofing with Snow Roof Systems' easy-to-apply elastic roof coatings.
Now available at the following fine home centers and hardware stores.
At Chevron, we considered some amazing ways to make it faster and easier for you to fill up when you're on the go.
One of them even turned out to be practical.
It's Chevron Fast Pay, where you pay right at the pump. Simply insert your Chevron card or any major credit card, get your gas, take your receipt, and take off. Chevron Fast Pay, simply smarter.
Back at G. Raleigh, where the Aggies lead the Raiders by one, and to the Dr. Pepper roundup of today's Southwest Conference action. If A&M wins today, then that much more importance on the second game of our doubleheader on most of these Raycom stations at 2 o'clock, Texas at TCU. Texas has lost the last 3 years in Fort Worth. If they lose again today and A&M wins, A&M gets the top seed. And then tonight, Rice and Houston, SMU and Baylor. Elsewhere around the country, halftime, Northwestern, a 7-point lead on Wisconsin. First half, Wake Forest by 3 at NC State. And also at the half, Virginia Commonwealth with an 8-point lead on South Florida. We're a 1-point game here. We're ready for the start of the second half in a moment.
From the top of the highest mountain, over land, over sea, in the desert, in the pits, when it absolutely has to start, the battery is Die Hard. Sears Die Hard. More power when and where you need it most.
You know those credit card commercials where they tell you to jaunt off to some exotic paradise? This isn't one of them, okay? We're taking our MasterCard to the supermarket. How's that for exotic? Actually, I guess it is kind of exotic. I mean, you've got a MasterCard. They've got tropical fruit and crystal clear water, right? And now, no card is more accepted on the planet, including supermarkets. And it's smart to use your monthly statement to keep track of your grocery spending. I mean, the supermarket isn't exactly paradise, but at least you can drink the water. MasterCard. It's more than a credit card. It's smart money.
What do you do after you introduce the first compact flare side on the planet? You make an even bigger splash. Announcing the Ford Ranger Splash Super Cab. Now the cool original also comes in a more spacious rendition. The 1994 Ford Ranger Splash and Splash Super Cab. Now how big a splash you make is up to you.
From Gillette comes a revolutionary form of antiperspirant protection. Gillette Clear Gel Antiperspirant. Because it's a clear, clean, powerful gel, it goes on smoothly with no white residue to form an invisible barrier of protection. All-day protection against both wetness and odor. Gillette Clear Gel Antiperspirant. One of the advanced deodorants and antiperspirants in the Gillette series.
Ben Naismith celebrates the 26th year of the Naismith Awards. This week's nominee is Cal's Jason Kidd. Last year's National Freshman of the Year recently set the Golden Bears' career steals record. And the preseason All-America is one of the nation's top assist leaders. Jason Kidd, the Ben Naismith nominee of the week. Conference Basketball on Raycom is brought to you by Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottlers. By Schick. By Sears. And by Ford and your local Ford dealers. Here's the Dr. Pepper halftime stats. You're going to wonder how A&M leads this game. They're being outshot from both the field and the line. That third line tells you how they are leading. 6 3-pointers and just one for Tech.
Chuck Henderson, 4 for 4 from the three-point line. That is phenomenal shooting of the basketball. One thing that A&M has to do a better job of is getting points off of the Texas Tech turnovers. If a team's going to cough the ball up 11 times, you need to take advantage of it. And we talked about it earlier, rebounds. Texas Tech, again, like they did in Lubbock, hammering A&M on the boards and block shots. Four of those block shots are all by Mark Davis,
which ties his season high for a game already. Leading scorer Sasser with 12 on 5 of 7 shooting. Hughes 9, including a 3. He's 4 for 6. Davis 6 with 8 assists and 4 blocks. He played all 20 minutes. Smith with 5 to finish out the picture for the Raiders. 13 for Brett Murray. 5 of 7, 2 of 3 from 3-point range. Henderson 12, all 3s. McGinnis 4, Broderson 4. You don't see very conspicuously Joe Wilbert's name there. He has just 3. He's their scoring leader for the year. Let's look at today's Ford game plan for the second half.
Texas Tech has to keep dominating in the paint, mainly by Jason Sasser, and don't make David Edwards into Goliath. He didn't shoot the ball real well in the first half, 1 for 4, but 5 rebounds and 8 assists. And for the Aggies, keep an eye on Wilbert. They need Joe to start playing and make it, take it. They have to keep shooting a good percentage. For the first half, they shot 43%, which is better than their last two games, but not as good as the 51% they were shooting a week ago.
And again, the Aggies know how to protect the lead at the half. That's what they have here, but a slim one. Coy Smith. Sasser. And Smith again, and they come up empty, but Smith stays after it. Sasser outside. And a 2 for Jason Sasser. And for the first time today, Texas Tech leads. Almost a 3-pointer for Sasser, now with 14. 6 of 8 from the field. Lost out of bounds. Touch last by Brett Murray. James Dickey with a 5-game winning streak coming in. Tony Barone with a 2-game losing streak.
This is the first time all year A&M has lost 2 consecutive games. Really surprising to see him lose to Norwich. And that's a credit to Tony Barone and his staff that they've been able to bounce back after some tough defeats. Not many defeats, but a couple.
Yeah, and what's got to be hard for him to deal with is they were probably really on the bubble at best for an NCAA tournament bid unless they win the championship in the tournament in Dallas next week. And now these last 2 losses may make it impossible for them to get there if they don't win the tournament.
And I don't want to get on my soapbox, but I'm tempted to because the Southwest Conference has three NCAA tournament teams. These two and the University of Texas should all three be in the tournament, and unfortunately, I don't think that'll happen.
Ooh, air ball by Murray. Where'd his shooting touch go?
Yeah, the last one he put up right before the end of the first half was an air ball also out there.
Hughes, catch and shoot, three, barely got iron. Ham kicks it back out to Smith, and now back underneath. Mark Davis on the turn is long. Edwards, another rebound. Far and away, their rebounding leader today. Wilbert with a power move and just his second basket.
Great job of getting Joe Wilbert involved early on, and good confidence for him. That was a tough move to make.
In and out for Smith's three-pointer. Wilbert saves it. But Sasser instead of Edwards with the loose ball and Hughes with the putback.
As a general rule, when you're saving the ball, never throw it back under the other basket. If you can't control it, just throw it up as high as you can in the air, but don't kick it out back under the basket because of that very reason.
This is an offensive foul. Wilbert spinning, had a great look at it from about 8 feet out, but that is his third personal. And Tech ball up one, 17-43 to go.
Well, it's no surprise, and we've talked a lot about Joe Wilbert struggling. We also ought to mention what a great job Darvin Ham's doing defensively on him. It's not totally that Joe Wilbert's struggling. They're playing great defense, and that's not a surprise. Ham's one of the best defensive players in the conference.
Of course, they lost Will Flemons last year, one of the top big men ever in the Southwest Conference. They wondered how they would fill that hole.
Yeah, that's a good call away from the ball. Mark Davis really moved on setting the screen. James, you go, what? Who? What are you talking about?
Him, there.
That's right.
And that's three on Davis. Cooper also with three for Texas Tech. And Wilbert, the only Aggie with three. Lance Broderson, very effective off the bench in the first half. And effective going to the hole here.
It shows you what a good athlete he was. He was a guard in high school, and you saw how well he handled the ball, put it between his legs, and made a nice move to the basket.
They will count on him for big stuff next year, just a sophomore from Naperville, Illinois. Tech turns it over again.
Oh, and James Dickey's furious. That's the same call. Now they call Darvin Ham moving on a screen, and Dickey's right. That time, the two players just ran into each other. A Tech player was running a cut, an A&M player was guarding a guy going the other way, and they just, that was an inadvertent contact. But the ref just looked up and saw the pow and made the call.
Ham now joining those with three fouls. A&M ball, they lead by one. Broderson backing in and misses a layup. Edwards is where all the loose balls are. McGinnis was too far underneath. Davis comes away. It's 5-on-1. Sasser fouled by McGinnis. Count the hoop.
Hey, that was a sweet dime down on the other end by David Edwards. Watch David Edwards just catch the ball and immediately go between his legs in a beautiful pass. McGinnis doesn't finish the playoff, but that is all you can ask for from a guard. And then on the other end, Texas Tech takes advantage of it. Great job of Mark Davis. You see how under control he was as he came down? He wasn't out of control to where he made the pass and he kept floating. He was able to go until somebody stopped him and then drop it off to Jason Sasser. That is a textbook, classic, perfect fast break.
And Sasser with the three-point play, giving Tech a two-point lead. 17 points for Sasser, 46-44 Tech. Basketball interest at both these campuses really reignited on these coaches. Hughes got the block of the three by Henderson. Jason Sasser almost lost it on the dribble. Coy Smith with the short banker. Sasser fouled by Corey Henderson. Jason Sasser playing the way he usually does, possessed. As intense as you can be. Today's telecast, a copyrighted presentation of Texas Tech, Texas A&M, the Southwest Conference, and Raycom Incorporated, intended solely for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast, retransmission, or other use of the video or audio portions of this program without prior written consent is forbidden.
I saw a great interview. James Dickey has nicknamed this young man the Ultimate Warrior. And they were asking Dickey about it, and Dickey didn't know there was a guy in the WWF by the nickname of Ultimate Warrior. And he was going, yeah, they told me the WFW, whatever that wrestling thing is. And then he goes, really, he's sad that he gave him that nickname now, because he said the Ultimate Warrior, then that gives it the connotation that there's something fake, and there's nothing fake about this young man. He is a legitimate competitor, one of the most fiercely competitive young men I've ever seen on the basketball floor.
I like the nickname for Lance Hughes, the Undertaker. Isn't that a wrestling guy, too, the Undertaker?
Yeah, Lance Hughes is a wrestling junkie.
Timeout, 15:57 to play. Tech with a 4-point lead.
3 decades in the making. Worth its weight in gold. The all-new Ford Mustang. It is what it was, and more. It's Motor Trend Car of the Year.
Well, he thinks that's wrong, but I guess that's all we have to go on. Okay. Gillette. Take the Gillette 3-point challenge. Clip the coupon in your Sunday, March 13th newspaper and go to a participating retailer to see if you want a shot at $1 million. No purchase necessary, void where prohibited. If you win $1 million, no purchase will ever be a problem for you. Necessary or unnecessary. Officials questioning whether that's the correct amount of time. As far as we can guess, it is, and they leave it at 15:57. One brief question they seem to have answered for themselves. Peck, despite 3-for-11 shooting here in the second half with their biggest lead of the game. Knocked out by Ham, a nice job fronting Wilbert.
Yeah, that was a beautiful job. He was fronting him on the other side of the lane and was able to beat Wilbert as he cut, was able to beat him over to the spot and still stay in front of him, and at the same time keep an eye on the basketball to be able to prevent the entry pass just like that again.
Eyes in the back of his head.
Yeah, that's great defensive play by Darvin Ham.
So the Raiders, within maybe one more bucket, of really having pretty good control of this game. And there it is for Sasser. He has all but 2 of their points this half. Edwards tried to force it into Wilbert. They turn it over. Now they may have an overrule. They do, and it's still A&M ball.
I always like it when I see officials do that, because one guy's down there and he's so close he can't see who the ball goes off of. And if another official has a clear angle to it, go ahead and tell him what you saw. I think that's a good job of officiating.
Ed Gatterdam, Frank Uso, and Kyle Need, the officiating crew today. 50-44, Texas Tech. This time they turn it over for sure. Offensive foul, Murray, his second.
What an outstanding job the Texas Tech Red Raiders are doing defensively on the interior down here. Outstanding post defense.
About the increase in basketball interest on both these campuses since James Dickey took over. Attendance in Lubbock up 126%. And up this year, 12% at A&M after a 41% increase last year. Nice stop that time by the Aggies. They needed it. Still within 6. Edwards on the penetration. Knocked out to Sasser. And the Raiders run it 4-on-2 if they hurry. Edwards sneaking from behind. Sasser travels after the steal. Too quick for his own good.
I mean, does David Edwards motor? Did you see how quick he came over and got that ball? Watch him. Look at him motor. He catches the ball, and then as he picks it up, that's a good call. He had control of the ball and actually slipped. And then as a result of it, David Edwards was mad and slammed the ball down and was getting ready to shoot a technical foul. Did you see how quick he closed on that ball, though? You think about a safety or a cornerback and how quick that they can close on a receiver. That's exactly what David Edwards looked like that time.
Boy, Smith hits the tee. You think R.C. Slocum might not have thought at least once or twice about making him a corner?
They could have just borrowed him just for about 9 or 10 weeks during the season, Coach.
51-44. Texas at 11-2. A one-point loss to A&M, a three-point loss, and double overtime to Tech. And they are in Fort Worth to take on TCU for the second game of our doubleheader on most of these Raycom stations.
What a great game that's going to be. As you mentioned earlier, TCU's beat them 3 years in a row in Fort Worth. Going to be a great basketball game after this great game.
Well, their comments this week are all about not being satisfied. They have clinched at least a tie for the top of the regular season. They're saying that's not our goal. Even winning the tournament isn't our goal. Getting far into the NCAA tournament is.
That's what I was talking about in the first half about Coy Smith posting David Edwards up more like he just did there.
Off Wilbert, out of bounds.
The fundamentals to playing post are catch the ball, check the defense, make your move. And Joe Wilbert is just rushing things so bad that when he does catch the ball, he's not checking the defense. And just then, he made the move before he ever caught the ball.
Barone said yesterday, if he's not right, he will not play. Now, he's played most of the day. Now you wonder how long he might go with Damon Johnson.
Yeah, Mark
Davis, 8 points. All of a sudden, it's a double-digit lead for the Red Raiders. Ham with a hustling effort at a steal, but he touched it last, and he ends up in the tuba section.
That's the fourth defensive play this afternoon that Darvin Ham has got his hand on the ball to knock away an easy basket.
Texas Tech opens this half with a 16-4 run, 12 unanswered points. Edwards saw a little space, but it didn't last very long. 13 and a half minutes to go. And there's the run for Tech. Brett Murray, intended for Johnson, stolen by Mark Davis, who has done everything for Tech today. Sasser for a three. Saved by Ham to David Edwards. 3-on-2 break, A&M spins 360, David Edwards.
Goodness gracious. Oh, and a foul after the back. Did you see that spin move? I tell you, as good as that spin move was, he just froze somebody up here. When he first got the ball on the steal, he froze somebody. Watch this. Ooh, is that a sweet shake? When you got a nickname of Boogie, and you're the career, and you're the career scoring leader in New York City, you expect stuff like that. That was sweet.
And then as Tech was bringing it back up, Damon Johnson called for his second foul, sixth against A&M. Tech close to the bonus. 55-46, Edwards finally stopping that run of 12 straight points. Very business-like second half for Texas Tech. Just kind of carving them up. Ham with almost an air ball, and it's out of bounds to A&M.
Good job by Damon Johnson of boxing out Jason Sasser. He made contact with him and then didn't lose the contact. Followed it all the way to the board and made Sasser come over his back where he couldn't control the rebound.
Edwards behind the arc for three.
Oh, Boogie feels it now. Don't get Boogie in a groove.
Went for the steal against Coy Smith. Argues about the call. It looked pretty clear cut. It's his second, and it is the team's seventh foul, so the bonus now for Texas Tech.
I'm sorry that young man's a senior. I have thoroughly enjoyed watching David Edwards play basketball. Right there, I mean, he's just feeling it. He's like, give me the ball and get out of my way. If I were Tony Brony right now, I might even ride that a little bit. I might go to their offense to where they put three guys down on the baseline and bring big Brett Murray out to set a screen and just do a little pick and roll and let David go.
Yeah, Barone's been very concerned his whole career here with holding David Edwards under control. Wonder if he might, in his last home game, kind of loosen the governor on him now.
Turn him loose, and especially with Wilbert not playing very well and not getting scoring from really anyone other than Chuck Henderson, I would. I'd isolate it and just say, hey, Dave, get off.
9 points for Coy Smith. And it's still 56-49 Tech. Well, Wilbert struggling. Johnson, their leading scorer and rebounder his first 2 years. Off year this year, just 2 points today. Not many other opportunities to get points. There's Johnson inside. A nice dish from McGinnis.
Did you see the look on Damon Johnson's face when he got the ball? He had his teeth gritted, and he took a power step to the basket like, I'm going to stick this one in.
Davis, three-pointer. 11 for Mark Davis. 58-51. They say it was a two. Had a toe over the stripe. Taken away by Davis.
Ooh, start the highlight film. Woo! And David Edwards is hurt. He's grabbing his knee. I think he just hurt it when he fell. I think he just knocked his knee on the ground. He slipped as he was running down, tripped on someone's foot.
Yeah, he's walking it off and seems to be okay. It happened simultaneously with the slam dunk by Mark Davis. I don't know if anybody really noticed what happened to Edward.
I did. I was holding up a 10.
Timeout. 9-point game. We'll be back after this word from Miller Genuine Draft.
Miller Genuine Draft, Rusty Wallace stock card. See it. Hear it. Feel it. Catch it, if you can.
Every Monday, I send out for Schlotzky's. It's good luck. One Monday, I was eating a Schlotzky's original. You know, three hot deli meats, real Wisconsin cheese, lettuce, tomatoes, onions, olives on those famous sourdough buns. When my buddy calls, boom, two Super Bowl tickets. Another Monday, my wife calls about the sonogram. She says you could see his little, toes. So, when I have Schlotzky's on Monday, I feel lucky.
Schlotzky's, Austin, San Marcos, and Round Rock.
Have brought home three state titles, and where each May brings a new spring festival queen. Yet Abbeville, South Carolina, is also a major financial center because it's served by Nations Bank, giving Canfield Dairy the same resources as any national corporation, providing the Thompsons on Turner Street the investments they'd find on Wall Street, and making sure folks don't have to take a back seat to anyone. In Abbeville and 1,900 other communities throughout our nation.
Here's the Schick game summary. And Texas Tech, despite not exactly burning the nets down this half, has dominated. Sasser 21, 9 of 16. A&M just 6 points off all the opportunities they've had from 13 Tech turnovers. Murray is scoreless this half. 13 for the game.
And rimless, too. I think he shot two air balls, hadn't he, this half?
He has. Edwards, a moment ago, looked like he was ready to take charge. Murray at least draws iron this time. And Edwards again, the first man to the rebound. His three-pointer, good.
Oh, goodness. Batten down the hatches because David Edwards has got it going.
His second three in a row to cut it down to a six-point game.
And look at him getting on his teammates saying, come on now, come on, let's get him.
A little more defensive intensity. Smith with the open three-pointer.
Oh, great double screen by Mark Davis and Janae Cooper, and a good job of Smith of just stepping into it.
And a crowd, Edwards. That very close to a three-point play. Cooper flopping, hoping to get the charge. There was no whistle. Edwards now with 8 in a row, 12 points in the game.
Look how many Red Raiders David Edwards went by. That's a good no call. Janae Cooper just flopped before Edwards ever even got there.
Power move. Sasser misses. Stays after it. Doesn't miss the second chance. 23 points, 12 rebounds for Jason Sasser. Edwards again.
Oh, man. The human highlight film. Just give him the ball and get out of his way. Goodness.
Welcome to College Station, New York, as far as David Edwards is concerned. Hughes. misses with a three.
And another great screen by Mark Davis. That's the second time down the floor, second consecutive time Mark Davis has set a great screen for a shot right there on the same spot on the floor.
Another double-digit lead for the Raiders. Not a whole lot of contact here, but they call it on Coy Smith, his first, team's third.
And James Dickey, what he's saying is, look, he got pushed into him from that screen. Coy Smith did a good job of fighting over the top of the screen. And James Dickey saying, look, that's who pushed him into Edwards, was the screener.
Takes him out and gets Chad Collins in off the bench.
Chad Collins got to feel like he just walked into a firing squad.
Henderson, three-pointer, just off. Collins the board. Neither team going very deep onto the bench today. Too much at stake. Three-pointer, Collins. Sasser falling out of bounds with no push. And Tech with the turnover. He begs to differ. So does his coach.
Jason Sasser plays so hard. He gets away. He has so much respect for his teammates. He gets away with stuff that other guys on the team couldn't. During practice, he yells at guys if they miss a layup. And he said that's because they're not concentrating. And the only way you can get away with something like that and treating teammates is if you have the ultimate amount of respect from them in return.
Roderson rejected and fouled. Davis almost with his fifth rejection. And instead, he comes away with the foul. His fourth. Biggest call in the game right here.
That is a big, big call. And I haven't mentioned it yet. With those four block shots in the first half, Mark Davis ties a Texas Tech single season block shot record that was held by Rick Bullock and by Mike Russell. And if you don't remember those guys, those were big, big wide body guys that played in the interior. So that's an outstanding statistic coming from a swing player like Mark Davis.
Maybe an indication, though, of how the conference has developed. Those guys were centers. Here's Davis. 6'7", 6'8", 210. And a lot of times looking more like a point guard in their scheme. Definitely more the outside player. Hughes going past Chuck Henderson.
And going real strong.
And the Undertaker knocking one down. 70-59. Henderson short for a three. Rebounded by Cooper for Tech. And they seem to have seized the momentum back one more time as we hit 9 minutes to play. Sasser. Outed by Broderson, but the pass was perfect.
That's right, and no weak side help. Tech did a good job of having good spacing so that there wouldn't be a defensive player on the backside to intercept that lob pass.
Timeout Aggies, their second. We're back after this from our friends at Chick.
Since your face can't adjust to your razor should adjust to your face, which is exactly why we designed the Schick Tracer. The Schick Tracer is the only razor with blades that bend and flex to the unique shape of your face. So the Tracer gets in close for a clean, comfortable shave. And since you can't change your face, maybe you should change your razor. Schick, you're changing the face of shaving.
Filtered Miller Genuine Draft. The cold one. For those who've discovered its smooth draft taste, the world is a very cool place. In the rain and snow, on the road again, I'm on the road again. So get out of the old and get into the cold.
Deep in the heart of Texas, and adored by lovers of the Old West, is Fort Worth. A city that not only has its own stock market, but is also a major financial center, because it's one of the 1,900 communities served by Nations Bank. Letting Justin Industries keep in step with the latest ideas in investment banking, giving families like the Trevinos a fresh start, and offering a range of resources that keeps people in Fort Worth from having to play second fiddle to anyone.
8:55 to play in College Station, all Texas Tech in this second half. Trailing the entire first half despite David Edwards' efforts to bring the Aggies back. They trail now by 13 points. Both shooting 50%, but Tech with that many more opportunities because A&M, which protected the ball very well in the first half, can't do it in this second half, and seven turnovers have really cost it. Don't forget, at the end of the game, we select the Dr. Pepper player of the game, looking more and more like Jason Sasser. 25 points to lead all scorers.
And 12 rebounds with 8:45 left in the game. Are those some numbers?
He got a hand on that one. Corey Smith unable to catch up to it. Aggie ball with 12 on the shot clock.
That was great hustle to cover up that time, because there was a breakdown defensively for Texas Tech, and Tony McGinnis was just standing under the basket all by himself.
Murray gets one to crawl home. His first points this half. 15 for the game. And the Aggies extend the D a little on the perimeter. Edwards out to rub off a screen by Cooper. Smith followed up by McGinnis.
And Janae Cooper's really setting some hard screens and is moving a little bit. He's going to have to work on getting his feet set, or he's going to get called.
Cooper rejected by Murray. Tech ball 10 to shoot.
Great job of Brett Murray. He actually Cooper was past him, but a good job of Brett Murray to keep moving his feet and not reach over and do something silly and just go straight up to block it. Nice defensive play.
Nice pass. Boy, Collins under some pressure. Probably had 1 second to get that in. Sasser broke wide open. He's got 27. Season high of 34 in the double OT against Texas. Broderson, 9 big points off the bench.
Lance Broderson's really giving him the scoring punch inside that Damon Johnson and Joe Wilbert have not this afternoon.
And we're down to 7.5 to play now. Not panic time for A&M, but they need a couple of stops. 74-63, Texas Tech. Hoping to end the regular season with a 6-game win streak and make the Aggie losing streak 3 in a row. Way off that time for Smith. Edwards had that 2 or 3 minute run where he was the Aggie offense, and he's now playing the subordinate role again. Broderson's miss followed by Murray's rebound and a Tech foul. On Cooper, his fourth. Don't forget, Longhorns and Horned Frogs coming up next. Most of these Raycom stations will have the second game of our doubleheader. And the import of that game, depending on what happens in this game. Aggies come back and win. Texas has to win to secure the top seed in the tournament. If Tech wins, they're the number 2 seed. If Rice and SMU both win tonight. The Owls play Houston. Ponies play Baylor. Murray was standing on the baseline.
I'm impressed. You've gone through the tiebreaker system now twice in a row and have done that same way. Good call. You can definitely see that Brett Murray stepped out of bounds. I think if you go through it one more time, I'm going to understand.
Well, I hate to admit this, but I've got it written down. Switch it. 6:30 to play. Now, if you're Tech, you don't want to get unaggressive too early. Shot clock down to 10. You don't want hurried shots, but you don't want to get too passive. With a whole lot of time remaining, a way out three by Smith. Almost followed in by Ham, stays after it, and loses control.
I think the observation you just made is absolutely correct. Texas Tech did not get the lead in this game by going down and running 30 seconds off the shot clock and then taking a shot with 5 seconds. And that's what they've done the last 2 consecutive times down the floor. Corey Smith has been forced to throw up a bad shot.
And McGinnis on the back door, 74-65. Texas Tech will talk it over. Their first timeout with 5 minutes and 50 seconds remaining. And a 9-point lead.
From Gillette comes a revolutionary form of antiperspirant protection. Gillette Clear Gel Antiperspirant. Because it's a clear, clean, powerful gel, it goes on smoothly with no white residue to form an invisible barrier of protection. All-day protection against both wetness and odor. Gillette Clear Gel Antiperspirant. One of the advanced deodorants and antiperspirants in the Gillette series.
We're a part of the future.
future with a heart and a soul.
Been messing with us again.
Let's ride.
Some people are such animals.
Here's the Pizza Hut delivery of the game. Guess who's on the delivering end?
None other than David Everts. And that's just a perfect job. Coach tells you that when you're coming down on a fast break, you go until somebody stops you. And you saw right there, none of the Texas Tech players really got in a position to stop David Everts. And as a result, he ends up shooting a layup.
Look at that. His second triple-double this year, his third of his career, and he is the only Texas A&M basketball player ever to have a triple-double.
Absolutely phenomenal, a triple-double. Hey, folks, we're talking about maybe two, maybe three guys in the entire country will get a triple-double in a season. For David Everts to have two of them is phenomenal.
Mark Davis has one already this year. He's close. Protect today. Ham hard on the offensive glass and draws the foul with 3 seconds on the shot clock. And it is Edwards' third.
And that goes back to the point you made a while ago. That's the third time down that Texas Tech has run the shot clock down and were forced to throw up a shot that wasn't necessarily what they would have taken had they had the shot come along sooner in the sequence.
Darvin Ham, junior college transfer, Otero JC in Colorado for 1 year. Just played 1 year of high school ball.
And in high school in Saginaw, Michigan, was teammates with University of Houston's Jesse Drain. Is that a serious pair of forwards in high school?
Yeah.
Wow.
And then last year at West Ark in Arkansas, where he did not play basketball. Not a whole lot of rust on him, though. 10-point game. 5:20 to play. And A&M needing a big closing rush to retain their hopes of a regular season co-championship. Broderson will draw the foul, sixth against Texas Tech in this half.
Lance Broderson doing a great job for Tony Brony off the bench. The last two games, Lance Broderson, especially against SMU, really struggled with hitting that shot at the free throw line. So what he's doing today, instead of even looking at it, he's just grabbing the ball and immediately driving into the lane. And he's been at the free throw line a bunch and is really doing a great job.
Darvin Ham now with four fouls. He joins Mark Davis and Janae Cooper with four.
Full court pressure by A&M.
Davis to bring it up. One thing to remember about Mark Davis, as great as he has been in his first year, he does lead the conference in turnovers at nearly five per game. Maybe an opportunity for A&M at some point with him bringing it up. Brett Murray outside, fouling Ham.
And I think that's great coaching right there. 4 minutes and 52 seconds to go. You're down by eight, and you go ahead and put a guy on the free throw line who's only shooting 50% for the season, and in Southwest Conference play, 43%. Great coaching move by Tony Brony, and that was certainly intentional. Brett Murray just ran out there and hacked him across the arm. I think there's a good juncture in the game to start that.
Foul on Murray was his third, and Ham again misses the front end. So it pays off on that side for the Aggies, but they need to cash it in on this side. Down by eight, 4:40 remaining. Chuck Henderson shut out this half after 4-for-4 shooting from three-point range in the first half. No small feat, mainly for Lance Hughes, who's had his assignment in the second half. Broderson, not the big three-point threat, but that is as big as it's been all day.
That was a huge bucket by Lance Brodersen.
And the Aggie crowd responding to cutting the lead to five. Smith misses a three. Sasser fouled after the rebound.
Tony McGinnis, look right there on your screen. He's over there on the weak side trying to rebound, and there's three Red Raiders, and Tony Barone's just kicking the Gatorade sign saying, somebody get over there with Tony McGinnis and block out. You have got to block out. Tony McGinnis cannot rebound against three Red Raiders on the weak side.
What a second half for Jason Sasser. 15 of his 27 points. For the day, 5 of 6 from the free throw line.
I heard a great line earlier in the year. Texas Tech was getting ready to play Texas, and James Dickey went over to Tom Penders and said, hey, what would you take for one of your guards? I need a point guard. And Penders goes, oh, that's easy. I'll take Sasser. And Dickey went, I don't think so.
Not a good trade.
I don't think so. James Dickey's got two good point guards coming in next year. A kid by the last name of Carr, and then he's got a red shirt right now, Jason Martin, transfer from Washington State, who's an outstanding point guard.
Barone, on the other hand, with a real problem because David Edwards will leave, and he does not, in his mind, have his replacement currently on his roster. Got a recruit from Chicago he hopes can take the job. Murray, 17 points. They're within four. You think it's loud now? Hang on. Smith dumping underneath to Sasser, and he quiets him down again.
Hey, that was great control to even catch that pass.
I think the catch was much better than the shot.
Absolutely. And better than the pass. One of those that, instead of saying great assist, you say, oh, great catch.
Sasser with 30, under 3 minutes, 78-72. Brodersen with a whistle on Cooper, who is gone.
Watch what a great job. Coy Smith has to force one up. Watch Jason Sasser just reach out and hang on to that ball and then have enough composure to come back up under on the other side. He is a warrior. I mean, he is a serious competitive kid.
So Jhené Cooper, the backup big man, true freshman from Killeen, fouling out with 3 points. Ham, who had not been out all that long, back in for Tech. Brodersen to the line. In a must situation, and he's one of their better free throw shooters.
Outside of Broderson's three-pointer a couple of possessions ago, all of A&M's points have been coming from Brett Murray and Brodersen catching the ball at the free throw line and then penetrating, driving in. And you can only get away with that if the other guys have great spacing. You have to have everyone else spaced out, because if you got a big guy dribbling the ball down the middle of the lane, I mean, he's going to attract a lot of attention, and a lot of little pesky hands are going to be in there swatting at it.
Barone got the big first half. Surprising offense from Bette Murray. In the second half, it's been Brodersen with the surprising points. Tech by four. Davis is short. Murray comes down with it. Edwards, long pass stolen by Ham. He underthrew it, badly intended for Lance Brodersen. Tech at 1 point, up by 13 in the second half. And that lead is melted to four with 2:24 to play. Sasser backing down Murray, the jump hook. How did that stay out? Edwards getting a tongue lashing in mid dribble by Tony Barone in front of their bench. Probably nothing he has not heard before. Brodersen. The foul on the Aggie rebound attempt. Tony McGinnis crashing in search of the loose ball, and that will be his fifth.
Texas Tech has all but lost a 13-point lead, and that's a problem James Dickey's had with this club all year long.
earlier against Rice, they had a, it was last Saturday, they had a 17-point lead in the second half that totally evaporated. Rice came back and got within one. And then against SMU, Texas Tech had an 18-point lead late in the game with just a couple minutes left, and SMU came back and got within one. So this is something that the Red Raiders have faced all season long.
Ricky's saying settle down. He's trying to settle himself down at the moment. Barely one of two for Mark Davis. 79-74, under two. Edwards driving on Smith. Howdy missed the lay-in. I think this may be how he looked off to Corey Henderson, and he thought too long about maybe dishing it off.
You're exactly right. He was looking off when he shot the ball.
Lance Hughes with the quick shot, and he's fouled. No shortage of aggressiveness by Lance Hughes with a minute 35 to go. That on Corey Henderson, his second. Hughes, number five in the conference. 74% from the line this year. This is his first trip today. If he hits them both, they lead by seven. He led them in the first meeting with 24 points. Out in Lubbock. One of two, 1:34 remaining, A&M down six. Edwards wanting to set up Chuck Henderson for a three. Not there, it's Corey Henderson instead. Hughes looks up, there's Mark Davis running the floor. Count the basket.
Oh, goodness. Do not foul a man in that situation at this point of the ball game, or if you're going to, do not let him stick a layup in that easy. Watch Corey Henderson just kind of bump him on the end, and it's a good hustle to hustle down there, but if you're going to foul him there, you don't foul him like that. You go ahead and you make it to where he cannot get the ball up past his waist and stick it in the hole.
So Mark Davis's three-point play, giving Tech a little cause for breathing room. 1:13 remaining. Edwards to the hole, misses again. Coming down with it, to no one's surprise, is Jason Sasser. And now Texas Tech just has to avoid the big mistake. We're under 1 minute. They have a 9-point lead. Very hard fought today in College Station. They trailed the entire first half. They led by as much as 13 here in the second half. Corey Henderson with his fourth foul. That stops it with 53.4.
And I don't understand that foul by Corey right there, because they allowed 14 seconds to run off the clock before he fouled him, and then he fouled him intentionally. If you're going to foul him, go ahead and do it quick before 14 seconds run off the clock. 14 seconds at this point in the ball game is an eternity of time.
Don't forget, on most of these stations, Texas and TCU coming up, and if A&M does not win this one, Texas Tech ties them for second in the conference, 10-4. And Texas has clinched the undisputed regular season title without even taking the floor yet at Daniel Meyer. 85-74. Texas heads into that one with an 11-2 contest mark. Corey Henderson's only points today. It's 85-76.
Yeah, foul now.
They let Davis get away, though, and now they've got numbers. And they can spread the floor and play a little keep away. Davis again fouled, and Corey Henderson has fouled out. A flurry of fouls in the last 2 minutes. And he joins Tony McGinnis on the bench for A&M with five. His replacement, Chris Williams, the true freshman from San Antonio MacArthur, playing in just his 11th game this year. One more year for this man. Sasser, just a sophomore. Ham, a junior. Smith, just a sophomore. Hughes, a junior.
What a great ball club James Dickey has to look out there and say, I've got all five of these kids coming back plus my top two subs, plus the kids they've gone out and recruited, plus Jason Barnes. They've got two other kids that are redshirted right now, Brock Barnes and Jason Hamm, that are both outstanding ball players. In fact, Dickey said if he'd have known how good they were going to be, he wouldn't have redshirted them.
Edwards uncontested. 16 points for Edwards in his G. Raleigh finale today. Last 28 seconds, Darvin Hamm.
With a monster dunk.
One for the highlight reel. Edwards again. Might have been different if he had been able to extend his personal run there midway second half. Passer back from Hughes. Edwards almost got the steal. This is a marvelous win for James Dickey and Texas Tech to improve to 16-10 heading into the tournament.
Yeah, to go into the tournament on a six-game winning streak, winning 10 out of your last 12, 15 out of your last 17, you couldn't hope to have a basketball team in a better position heading into your conference tournament.
They win it at G. Raleigh White by 89-80. Their sixth consecutive win, their longest winning streak since 1985-86 when they won the Southwest Conference title. The Aggies lose their third in a row to fall to 17-9, and they tie for second in the league at 10-4. We will be right back in College Station in a moment.
So, what are we doing today?
I'd like to go buy some flowers.